أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. In the last session, we saw the hadith which shows that for a woman, deen is the utmost thing she should take care of, and she should be learning Islam rather than falling into other things and taking them as a means of gaining people's attention. So this is Islam that makes a woman worthy in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dunya and akhirah. Now we come to another hadith which shows that it is the duty of a woman to take care of the members of the family. جابر رضي الله تعالى عنه says, عن جابر قال قال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم هل نكحت يا جابر قلت نعم. رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم asked me, هل نكحت يا جابر, O Jabir, have you married? قلت نعم, I said yes. قال ماذا أبكرا أم ثيبا قلت لا بل ثيبا. He said, did you marry a bikr or you married a thayyib? Bikr is a woman who was not married before. Who got married for the first time, virgin. Am thayyiba, a woman who was divorced or she was a widow and then she got married for the second time. This woman is called thayyib. Qultu la bal thayyiba. He said, no, but I married a thayyib. قال فهل جارية تلاعبك. Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told him, asked him, why did you not marry a جارية, a virgin? تلاعبك, she would have played with you. قلت يا رسول الله إن أبي قتل يوم أحد وترك تسع بنات كن لي تسع أخوات فكرهت أن أجمع إليهن جارية خرقاء مثلهن ولكن امرأة تمشطهن وتقوم عليهن. قال أصبت. He said, O Messenger of Allah, my father got killed on the day of Uhud. He was martyred. وترك تسع بنات. And he left 9 daughters after him. And he said, كن لي تسع أخوات. I had 9 sisters. فَكَرِهْتُ أَنْ أَجْمَعَ إِلَيْهِنْ. I did not like. فَكَرِهْتُ أَنْ أَجْمَعَ إِلَيْهِنَّ جَارِيَةً خَرْقَاءَ مِثْلَهُنْ. I felt bad and it seemed wrong to me that I should marry a woman of the same age of my sisters and add one more to them. خرقاء, a woman who does not know the dealings at home. She cannot do things properly. A woman who does not have any experience of family matters. So, an ajma ilayhinna jariyatan kharqa. Kharqa actually is fool. So, a woman who does not know the matters of household matters, and she cannot take care of my sisters. And kharqa amitlahun. And not exactly a fool, a woman who cannot take care of family matters, who is not very intelligent, who is not knowing what to do and how to do things, who has no experience of family things, like them. وَلَكِنْ إِمْرَأَةً تَمْشُطُهُنَّ وَتَقُومُ عَلَيْهِمْ. But I thought that I should marry a woman who can comb their hair and تَقُومُ عَلَيْهِمْ, be a stand upon them and take care of them. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, asabta, you made the right decision, you were right, asabta. In another riwayah, he said, فَتَزَوَّجْتُ ثَيِّبًا تُعَلِّمُهُنَّ وَتُؤَدِّبُهُنَّ. I married a thayyibah so that she should teach them. تُعَلِّمُهُنَّ وَتُؤَدِّبُهُنَّ. She should teach them deen and she should make them, bring them up with good manners. تُؤَدِّبُ. She should teach them deen, aqidah, ahkam and all these things, family matters, and how a girl should remain in the family and in her husband's family. So she should teach them this. وَتُؤَدِّبُهُنْ. And she should teach them good manners and adab. Adab in deen. So this hadith shows that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam urged that Jabir radiallahu anhu should have married a bikr, virgin. But he said, no, I had many responsibilities and I have 9 sisters and in my family there is no one to look after them. So I married a woman who is much experienced in family things, family matters, and she is used to how to bring children up, how to treat children and teach them things and take care of the family things, food and eating and clothing and everything. So I married such a woman who has experience. And وَلَكِنْ إِمْرَةً تَمْشُطُهُنَّ وَتَقُمُ عَلَيْهِنْ. And she should comb them and be their responsible person in the family in my absence. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَصَبْتَ. You did the right thing. And he said that she should teach them ilm and adab. So some women think that it is not their duty that they should be taking care of the family members, the father and the mother of the husband and his sisters and the other people in the family at home. And they say that we will not do this. But Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Jabir radiallahu ta'ala, marrying for this reason, thayyiba, he said, she should take care of my sisters. That's why I married such a woman. And he did not say, you did the wrong thing. This is not the duty of a woman. This is not the duty of the wife. You should have sent them to some orphanage or something. No. But he said, asabta, you made the right decision. So if a person marries a woman so that his parents, she can take care of the parents, she can take care of his sons and daughters from the previous wife, he has divorced her, or she has died, and this woman comes as a wife in that home, she should be worthy enough, she should be merciful enough to take care of these matters, to look after his children, to look after his sisters, brothers, and those who are not above age, like brothers. So this is the duty of the wife, that she should take care of the family matters. There is no such hadith that Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that women should not do this and they should not do this. But it is her intelligence that she wins the heart of the husband through the family members, especially the parents. And when a person marries, many of the girls and women, when they marry, they say, see, in Islam, upon women, there is nothing as such. No clothes, no laundry and no nothing. And you will have to do it yourself. So this is not the way. It doesn't work this way. If a person does it himself, it's good. But if he demands it from his wife, she should be ready for doing these things. And he can command her. He can demand it from her. This is the thing which a woman should remember. In the Indian families, especially, if she does not do the household work, there is going to be a rift between the husband and the wife. He will not like her. Then he will start torturing her. And the life becomes a burden for the woman. And she is punished for what she is not doing from her mother-in-law and father-in-law and other relatives. So she should take care of the family business and like actually family matters, not family business actually. The family things. Cooking food, clothing, and keeping the house clean and tidy. She can demand from the husband that she keeps a woman for working, a bond servant, or like a working woman or man at home, but it's her intelligence that she takes care of the house overall and the people in the house, especially their food and clothing. So from this hadith, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not prohibit Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu from taking such sort of work or responsibility, giving this responsibility to his wife, taking care of the sisters. On the contrary, he said, you have done the right thing, that you are marrying for such purpose, to take care of your sisters. It's okay, it's no problem, asabta, you have taken the right decision. So this hadith shows that a good woman, a woman, a righteous woman, a Muslim wife, she takes care of the relatives of the husband, especially those who really need her standing for them and taking care of them. So she should be doing this. Now we come to a point, safeguarding the self-respect and chastity. An Abdullah ibn Salam, anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, khayrun nisa'i tasurruka idha absarta wa tu'tika idha wa tuti'uka. Actually it is a mistake in tuti'uka, it should be tuti'uka. Tuti'uka, tuti'uka means to give. She gives you. Actually it is tuti'uka, she obeys you. It's a printing mistake. In some of the softwares, the typing mistakes are there, like Shamil and other softwares. This is tuti'uka idha amarta. The best of the women, the best women are those, or the best woman is she who tasurruka idha absarta. When you look at her, she pleases you. Wa tuti'uka idha amarta. And she obeys you when you command her. وَتَحْفَظُ غَيْبَتَكَ فِي نَفْسِهَا وَمَالِكَ. And guards her person and your possessions in your absence. Three things are there. Who is the best woman? One, she is not angry with her husband due to her petty salary. And all the time she is showing her anger. And whenever he looks at her, she shows that I am angry. He has not given her what she wanted, like some purse or some jewelry or something. And he did not take her to some movie, or he did not take her to some relatives. And she is angry with him. So this is not a good wife. A good wife is a woman, when her husband comes home from his office, from shop, from all the battle outside, for the food and the clothing and the requirements of the family members, and he comes from outside at home, and when he looks at her, his wife, and when he sees that she is following the commands of Allah, she's having hijab, she's a pious woman, she's performing salah, and she is a pleasant woman in her speech and manner, it pleases him. حَبْلَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنَ. He's a person, when he comes home, he feels that no matter what happens to me outside, when I come home, my wife is waiting for me, and she likes me and I like her, and she will make me happy. Whenever, the moment I reach home, she will not say, the dinner is in the fridge, take, eat and go to sleep. No. But she will tend to me, and she will look after whatever I need, and she will talk to me and make my burden light. Tasurruka idha absarta. The sight of her pleases you. Wa tuti'uka idha amarta. And she obeys you whenever you command her. A good woman, a Muslim woman, a pious woman, a righteous woman, knows that she has to obey the husband. We will see it in another hadith, which makes it very clear that unless she obeys and pleases her husband, she cannot please Allah. وَتُطِعُكَ إِذَا أَمَرْتَ. She obeys you whenever you command her. A person, the husband says, just bring me some water. I'm feeling thirsty. And she's telling him from the kitchen, don't you have 2 feet? Can't you just get up and take the water? And how many things should I do? I'm tending the children, I'm doing this and that. You take it for yourself. It's not wrong actually for him to go and take it himself. But sometimes such small things matter. And her obeying him, especially in small matters, gives him the feeling that I am the owner of the family. I am the head of the family. And I have such a good wife that whatever I command her, she obeys. So this gives him the sense of security, the sense of superiority. So this is necessary for a woman, that she obeys the husband. But if he commands us to do something evil, something wrong, so she should not obey him. وَتَحْفَظُ غَيْبَتَكَ فِي نَفْسِهَا وَمَالِكَ. And she guards her person, herself, from all the evils. She, in his absence, she is not with hijab. In his absence, he is not chatting with strangers on Facebook or WhatsApp. In his absence, in any way, she shouldn't be doing this. And in his absence, she does not let any stranger or a person he does not like to come and enter his home. So, وَتَحْفَظُ غَيْبَتَكَ فِي نَفْسِهَا. In her person, guards us, her chastity in his absence. And وَمَالِكَ. And your man, his possessions. That he is earning all the money with hard work and she's spending it freely and buying things which are not necessary for home. So this is wrong. She should save his money and use the money when it is given to her. She should use that money very intelligently, carefully, and in the right places. So this is the hadith which shows that a woman should save her person and his property. Her person and his property. Obedience. What is the reward if the wife obeys her husband? عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا صلت المرأة خمسها وصامت شهرها وحسنت فرجها وأطاعت بعلها دخلت من أي أبواب الجنة شاءت. He says إذا صلت المرأة خمسها. If a woman performs salah 5 times a day, If she prays 5 times, she takes care of all the 5 salah, not leaving one. She prays 5, her 5 salah. وَصَامَتْ شَهْرَهَا. And she fast for the whole month of Ramadan. وَحَسَّنَتْ فَرْجَهَا. And she preserves her chastity. She preserves her respect. That means she does not indulge in zina. Or she does not show her ornaments, a beauty, and hijab, takes away her hijab. حَسَّنَتْ فَرْجَهَا. Especially she does not involve in zina. وَأَطَعَتْ بَعْلَهَا. And she, أَطَعَتْ بَعْلَهَا. بَعْل means husband. She obeys her husband. دَخَلَتْ مِنْ أَيِّ أَبْوَابِ الْجَنَّةِ شَاءَتْ. She will enter Jannah from whichever of its gates she pleases. It will be her choice. It will be said on the Day of Judgment, you can enter Jannah definitely. Now which door, it's your choice. You enter Jannah from whichever door you want, whichever gate you want, you can enter. This is to show that it's your choice now. It's no restriction for you. You are worthy of entering Jannah. And whichever door or gate you want, you please, you can enter Jannah from that door. So this will be in as an honor for the woman who does 4 things. It's a simple formula. 4 points. 1, 5 times salah a day, especially fajr, and saum of shahar. Because of the menses and the days which women have in her month, if she does not fast all the saum of Ramadan, it's not a problem. She can do the qada of this siyam later on. So this is wasamat shahraha. Not necessary that in that month she should fast, but she completes the number. So wasamat shahraha. Wahassanat farjaha, abstains from zina and the things that lead to zina. Wa ata'at ba'laha, and she obeys her husband. So she will definitely enter Jannah, and she will choose which door she wants to enter Jannah from. So salah, sawm, and safety from zina and all the indecency, and obeying the husband. So see, obeying the husband is such an important thing. But no doubt, obeying in the right things, not in sin. If the husband wants to take her to some movie or some party without hijab, or he asks her to do some wrong things, she will not obey him if that is not allowed in Islam. Some ghiba or some other things, she will not do. She will not obey him. Stealing and lying and all these things, she will not listen to him. Now we move ahead. And Abi Umamah radiallahu anhu qal, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi sallam, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi sallam li Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi sallam told Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Now see, in the previous hadith, we had seen that a woman is the best of the possessions, mata'. In this hadith, she is mentioned as a kanz. Kanz is a treasure. She is valuable. She is not without value in dunya. She is the most valuable thing a person can have. She is a treasure. She is far superior than all the treasures. Who? وَزَوْجَةٌ صَالِحَةٌ. What is the hadith? Ya Mu'adh. He told Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Ya Mu'adh, O Mu'adh, قَلْبٌ شَاكِر. A heart that is grateful, thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A grateful and thankful heart. وَلِسَانٌ ذَاكِر. A tongue that utters the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It means that it denotes that we should do dhikr with lisan and not just heart. وَلِسَانٌ ذَاكِر. The tongue that utters the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَزَوْجَةٌ صَالِحَةٌ. And a righteous woman, a righteous wife. زَوْجَة, wife. تُعِينُكَ عَلَىٰ أَمْرِ دُنْيَاكَ وَدِينِكَ. Who supports you, who helps you in the matters of dunya and deen. خَيْرُ مَكْتَنَزَ النَّاسِ. خَيْرُ مَكْتَنَزَ النَّاسِ. She's better than all the treasures which people are gathering or have gathered. So a righteous woman is much better than, far superior than all the treasures which people are gathering in dunya. So she is better than all the treasures. So in Islam, a righteous woman is much higher, better, more valuable, worthier than kanz. Kanz is treasure. So it's a term of respect for a woman. Because Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, someone may say, she is not a commodity, she is not a kanz, it's not a property. Now what would you say about lisanun dhakir and qalbun shakir? This is also mentioned as much more better than a kanz. So she is mentioned with these two very important things. One is qalbun shakir, a heart that is full of shukr for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. and a tongue, a lisan, which remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are such a valuable things. And among them and with them, a righteous woman is mentioned. A good heart and a good tongue, which remembers Allah, shukr and dhikr, and then a righteous woman. Who does what? تُعِينُكَ عَلَىٰ أَمْرِ دُنْيَاكَ وَدِينِكَ. Who supports you in your worldly matters and supports you in your religious matters. Like Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha. She used to take all the food to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to Hira, and he used to stay there for days and days and nights. And she used to take food for him and used to stay there in Hira, the cave of Hira. And she used to give him food and all whatever he needed, and she used to walk all the way to him. And in deen, she supported him like anything. She gave all her maal for the da'wah, and she supported, she was with him, she stood by him in all the trials he faced, which all the problems which came to him from Quraysh. And she was with him. She stood by him. So this is وَزَوْجَةٌ صَالِحَةٌ تُعِينُكَ عَلَىٰ أَمْرِ دُنْيَاكَ وَدِينِكَ. In your worldly matters and the matters of deen. For example, if a person has to do some office work at home, and if you can help him, you help him in his dunya, because he's earning that money for you. But don't make the wrong calculations. You help him properly if you can. You can do some work which can help him in his office work. Or in dunya, you can wake him up in Fajr, which many women do not do because he gets angry. So you wake him up for Fajr, and you help him in learning deen, and you help him in following the sunnah and facing all the society, the consequences in denouncing bid'ah. The relatives and all, they get angry when you follow sunnah and denounce bid'ah. So you stand by him. You don't let him alone. But you support him in his deen. In family matters, in society, in dealing with his parents, you stand by him. You support him. So, وَزَوْجَةٌ صَالِحَةٌ تُعِينُكَ عَلَىٰ أَمْرِ دُنْيَاكَ وَدِينِكَ خَيْرُ مَكْتَنَزَ النَّاسِ. It is the best of the treasures which people are hoarding, gathering. So she is a treasurable person. She is like a treasure. She is so valuable. She is equated. No. She is not called equal to these treasures. Is she equal? No. خَيْرُ. She is better than these treasures. She is better than that. She is better than money. She is better than jewelry. She is better than all that a person can buy. She is a woman. She is her wife. His wife. So, she's better than all these treasures. Now we come to what is the haq of the husband upon his wife. An Abdullah ibn Abi Awfa radiallahu anhu qal, لَمَّا قَدِمَ مُعَاذٌ مِّنَ الشَّامِ سَجَدَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ سَجَدَ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَال مَا هَذَا يَا مُعَاذٌ. Abdullah ibn Abi Awfa says, Lamma, when Qadima Mu'adhu min al-Sham, when Mu'adh ibn Jabal returned from Sham, Syria, sajada lil Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He did sajda to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ma hadha ya Mu'adh? O Mu'adh, what is this? What are you doing? Qala ataytu al-Sham, fawafaqtuhum yasjuduna li asaqifatihim. When I went to Sham, when I went to Syria, I saw people do sajda to their asaqifatihim wa batariqatihim. I saw people doing sajda to their leaders and their patricians and big people and their religious authorities. فَوَدِدْتُ فِي نَفْسِي أَن نَفْعَلَ ذَلِكَ بِكَ. I thought that this is a great thing that we should do to you. If people can do sajda to their leaders, you have the highest status among us. we should be doing this to you. So I felt good that we should do to you, do sajda to you. فَوَدِدْتُ فِي نَفْسِي أَنَّ فَعَلَ ذَلِكَ بِكَ فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَلَا تَفَعَلُوا. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, no, do not do this. Don't do this. فَلَا تَفَعَلُوا. Don't do this. فَإِنِّي لَوْ كُنْتُ آمِرًا أَحَدًا أَنْ يَسْجُدَ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَأَمَرْتُ الْمَرْأَةَ أَنْ تَسْجُدَ لِزَوْجِهَا. If I were to command someone to do sajda besides Allah, to other than Allah, if there were someone whom I would have commanded to do sajda to besides Allah, لَأَمَرْتُ الْمَرْأَةَ أَنْ تَسْجُدَ لِزَوْجِهَا. I would have commanded a woman, a wife, to do sajda to her husband. وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ. By Allah, by Him, in whose hands Muhammad's life is, بِيَدِهِ نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ لَا تُؤَدِّي الْمَرْأَةُ حَقَّ رَبِّهَا حَتَّى تُؤَدِّيَ حَقَّ زَوْجَهَا. By the one in whose hand is my soul, the soul of Muhammad, no woman can fulfill her duty towards Allah until she fulfills her duty towards her husband. And in another narration he said, لَا يَصْلُحُ لِبَشَرٍ أَنْ يَسْجُدَ لِبَشَرٍ. It is not right for a bashar, it is not correct, lawful, it is not right for a bashar or a person or a human to do sajda to a bashar. وَلَوْ سَلَحَ لِبَشَرٍ أَنْ يَسْجُدَ لِبَشَرٍ. If it were right for a person to do sajda to another, لَأَمَرْتُ الْمَرْأَةَ أَنْ تَسْجُدَ لِزَوْجِهَا. I would have commanded the woman, a woman, to do sajda to her husband, من عظم حقه عليها, due to her, his, من عظم حقه عليها, due to his, the greatness of his rights upon his wife, due to his, the greatness of his rights upon her. So these are the two ahadith. One is in Ibn Majah, Sunan Ibn Majah, and the other is in Musnad Ahmad and Nasai. From these two narrations, we learn a lot of things from these two narrations. One is, can we discuss this hadith? What do we learn from this hadith? Number one, we cannot do sajda to anyone. Some people say that there are two types of sajda. One is the sajda of ta'zeem and the other is the sajda of ibadah. So we can do the sajda, some people say this, we can do the sajda of ibadah to Allah only and none else. But the sajda of ta'zeem is okay, we can do it to any wali or shaykh or some big scholar. Is it right?
No.
Why not?
They are all human
and the Prophet ﷺ prohibited them. Which was, this sajda was sajda of ibadah or respect? This was a respect, because he saw that people were doing this to their leaders and bishops and patricians or patriarchs. So he said, we should do it to you. He did not say that we should do your ibadah, because Sahaba knew this. And like Mu'adh ibn Jabal, who was sent to Sham as a teacher and a person of knowledge. So he came to Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said that we should do it as a respect to you. But Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَوْ كُنْتُ آمِرًا أَحَدًا أَنْ يَسْجُدَ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. It means that we should not do sajda to anyone besides Allah, other than Allah. If I were to do so, لَوْ, لَوْ comes for a statement when, if I would have done this, I had I done this, I would have told a woman to do sajda to her husband. So I am not going to tell, because in the hadith it says that la yasluhu li basharin ay yasjuda li bashar. It is not lawful for a person to do sajda to another person. If I were to command, I would have commanded a woman to do sajda to her husband. So if I were to command, I have not commanded. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not command Sahaba to do sajda to other people, neither women nor men to worship or do sajda of ta'zeem to someone else. So sajda of ta'zeem is not allowed in Islam. So we learn from this hadith that one thing is that sajda is not allowed to anyone other than Allah. لا تسجدوا للشمس ولا للقمر واسجدوا لله الذي خلقهن. So makhluq is not worthy of sajda, only khaliq is worthy of prostration or sajda. And the other thing we learn is that the greatness of the rights of the husband upon the wife. من عظم حقه عليها. This is the second thing, that the right of the husband is so great that Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have commanded the wife to do sajda too, but he did not. This shows that the rights of husband are so huge and great and important. Another thing is that he said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ لَا تُؤَدِّ الْمَرْأَةُ حَقَّ رَبِّهَا حَتَّى تُؤَدِّيَ حَقَّ زَوْجِهَا. That if a woman does not give the haqq of the husband to him, she cannot fulfill the responsibilities, she cannot be deemed as one who has fulfilled the responsibilities of to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا تؤدي المرأة حق ربها حتى تؤدي حق زوجها. So to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she should please her husband, provided that he is a rightful person and he is not telling her to do something which is beyond Islam, outside the commands of Islam. So she should keep him happy. So this hadith shows the woman should respect her husband, and sajda. See, the deal is that for respect they wanted to do sajda to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But he said, no, you cannot do this. If I were to command this sajda of respect, I would have commanded a woman to do this to her husband. So a woman should respect her husband. This is necessary, especially for a good life or a life of harmony. Respect is necessary. A woman should not make jokes about her husband, especially in front of her other members of the family. From her mother's side. So sometimes women do this, and then husband realizes that she did said such a thing about me to her mother, her sisters and her brothers, and they make fun of me, and he does not like that. So this is a very important thing you should remember. So respecting the husband is necessary for the wife. Now we come to one hadith which is often misunderstood and misquoted, we can say, in showing that Islam deems women as devilish and women are going to Jahannam. An Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu qala an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wasallam uritu an-nar fa idha aktharu ahliha an-nisa. I was shown Jahannam, the fire of hell. فَإِذَا أَكْثَرُ أَهْلِهَا النِّسَاءُ. And I saw that most of the dwellers of Jahannam, majority of the people in Jahannam are women. And he said, يَكْفُرْنَ. They do kufr. They commit kufr. Now we know that kufr in general is rejection of truth. And kufr also stands for ungratefulness. Kufr stands for rejection of truth, and kufr also means ungratefulness. So he gave a general word which was not clear. He said, what is the reason women going to Jahannam and majority of women in Jahannam? He said, yakfurn, just one word, they do kufr. Now Sahaba were confused. They asked, قِيلَ أَيَكْفُرْنَ بِاللَّهِ Sahaba asked, do women commit kufr of regarding Allah? Now if they are asking about really kufr, so are they doing kufr of Allah, having more gods other than Allah, or denying the existence of Allah, or denying the tawheed of Allah? So أَيَكْفُرْنَ بِاللَّهِ, they wanted a clarification. He said, يَكْفُرْنَ الْعَشِيرِ وَيَكْفُرْنَ الْإِحْسَانِ. Now, the Prophet ﷺ made it more clear. He said, they commit ungratefulness. They are ungrateful to their husband, their husbands. يَكْفُرْنَ الْعَشِيرِ وَيَكْفُرْنَ الْإِحْسَانِ. And they are ungrateful to the ihsan favors of their husbands, ungrateful for the favors done to them by their husbands. لو أحسنت إلى إحداهن الدهر ثم رأت منك شيئا قالت ما رأيت منك خيرا قط. He said, what is the reason they go to hell, these women who are in hell? What is the reason and what is the nature? If you have always been good to them, and just one or two things or some things they find wrong in you, and you cannot fulfill the things which they require. لو أحسنت إلى إحداهن الدهر, long ages and life, a long part of life goes on, and you fulfill everything that you have to do and do ihsan upon them, but after some time they see some deficiency and you do not do what they want. So مَرَادْ مِنْكِ شَيْءٍ, they see some shortcomings in you, in your favors. قَالَتْ, what will they say? مَا رَأَيْتُ مِنْكَ خَيْرًا قَطْ. مَا رَأَيْتُ مِنْكَ خَيْرًا قَطْ. I did not see a single good thing from you. مَا رَأَيْتُ مِنْكَ خَيْرًا قَطْ. I have never seen goodness in you all my life. So this is the reason. This is in Bukhari and Muslim. You must be saying that we don't say like this. So these are the women who will say and who behave this way. They will be the dwellers of Jahannam. Now some people, some Christian missionaries, they say that, see, we have been saying that in Islam, women are the dwellers of hell. And this is the situation of women, that most of the dwellers of Jahannam will be Nisa. So what do you say about this? Is it so or not, or why not? And what does this hadith mean then? How do you resolve the problem, the difficulty in the hadith? The Christians say that women are evil in Islam also. Why? Because the hadith says, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that majority of women will be in hell. So not men, women. So majority of hell dwellers are women. So they are evil, more evil than men. Is it true?
It's not true, because in Islam women have been given the highest status.
Yes.
Whereas a Christian ka, jo bhi hai, Christian ka, they don't have the sense of believing in Allah.
But we have the hadith in front of us. So what do we make of this hadith? Any answer?
It does not mean that women are created evil.
But they become evil. We can give a try. Yes. This is to encourage them by telling them that you will go to hell, most of you. It's a warning that you are evil.
No.
Women.
No.
No.
It's not that. It's not that.
But he saw. See, he is not just giving a warning. He said, Uritunnar, I saw. So it's an actuality. It's not just a warning, but what he saw.
But here the condition is that if you're ungrateful, then only.
Definitely. Are the women going to hell just because they are women?
No.
Because of what? Because of some deed. If these women abstain from these deeds, will they go? No. So the women who are going to hell is because of some wrong deeds they have committed, and this is yakfurna, because of their ungratefulness. And if a woman abstains from that, she will not go. So none of the dwellers of hell and the women, these women, will be sent to hell just because they are women. So woman is not evil in Islam. These deeds are evil, and if a woman commits these deeds, they will, even a man, if he is not grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the ihsan, he will go to hell. So it is not a question of just man or woman, it is a question of the deeds. So the going into hell, entering hell, is not because of the womanhood, it is because of the wrong deed, evil deed, and ungratefulness. If a woman can save herself from this, she will not, even if she is a woman. So it is not a question of woman and man, it is a question of the deed. Yakfurna al-ihsan. So this at the same time shows that what is the cause of women entering Jahannam. So appreciating what the husband is doing is part of deen. No matter what you do, you have to do it. And what I am doing, cooking and doing, this is ihsan. This is not good. She should appreciate. Have we ever, like women, sitting with the husband and telling him that you do so much for us, Jazakallahu khairan. Do we say that? We means you. So a woman should say
this. It depends upon the deeds that side do.
Yes.
It's not always the women, right?
Yeah. Even the men also, they do not sit with the women and their wife and say that you cook for me and you do all these things for me and you have done a lot for me, that I pray to Allah that He makes you enter Jannah. Even men do not do this. So this is bad, this is evil. And this hadith teaches us that we should appreciate the ihsan. We should appreciate the ihsan. Women or men, all of them, they should appreciate what others do to us, do for us. And if we do not, that can lead to Jahannam. And not just that, not appreciating the good deeds by the husband, but she's lying. What she's saying, Rasulullah said, why did these women go to Jahannam? لو أحسنت إلى إحداهن الدهر ثم رأت منك شيئا قالت ما رأيت منك خيرا قط. I have never seen goodness from you. No goodness came to me from your side. You did not do any good to me. He has done a lot of good things, but she denies his goodness altogether. So this is a dhulm. This is dhulm. So because of this dhulm, because of this wrongdoings, transgression and ungratefulness, a person will go to Jahannam. So this is about women. About men, there are other ahadith that they are also going to Jahannam. So it is not that men are very happy, they should be happy that no, see, we are saved from Jahannam. No, men can go to Jahannam because of some other deeds which they will commit in the family. Now it's about men, the next hadith. عن معاوية القشيري رضي الله عنه قلت يا رسول الله ما حق زوجة أحدنا عليه. معاوية رضي الله عنه asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, O Messenger of Allah, ما حق زوجة أحدنا عليه. What are the rights of our wives upon us? قال أن تطعمها إذا طعمت وَتَكْسُوَهَا إِذَا اكْتَسَيْتَ أَوْ اكْتَسَبْتَ وَلَا تَضْرِبِ الْوَجْهَ ولا تقبح ولا تهجر الا في البيت. He said that the right, now see Islam, he's asking the companion, man is asking about woman, husband is asking about wife. ما حق زوجة أحدنا عليه, what is the right of a wife upon the husband? And he says that you should feed her when you eat, and you should provide her with clothing when you buy or when you buy clothes for yourself. ولا تضرب الوجه, and you should not hit her, strike her upon her face. You should not strike her. ولا تقبح, and do not do تقبيح. تقبيح is saying that may Allah make your face evil. This is تقبيح. Or if she is not having a very beautiful face, the husband should not say that you're not beautiful, your face. If I see you, whenever I see you, my heart breaks. So even if she's not a beautiful woman, the husband should not say such things to his wife, or say that whenever I see you, the whole day goes bad and evil. So such things is taqbih, or making a dua to the wife, cursing her, may Allah make your face evil. Taqbih is this. So wala tuqabbih, wala tahjur illa fil bayt, and do not cut off relation with her only in the house, at home. Do not, like, we will come to this. First thing is, when you eat, you feed her. It is not that you go to some big hotels and you eat whatever you want, Arabian food, and your wife is eating, you know, small petty things, and you come at home and say, I have taken my dinner and I have had my lunch, and you the husband does not feed the wife properly. So أن تطعمها, she should not go hungry. The husband should feed her when he is eating. It is his responsibility to take care of her food, providing her food for eating. وَتَكْسُوَهَا إِذَا اكْتَسَيْتَ أَوْ اِكْتَسَبْتَ. اِكْتَسَيْتَ, where? اِكْتَسَبْتَ, you earn. So whenever you earn money and whenever you buy clothing for yourselves, you should provide your wife with clothing. This is much more like he has to provide her more than he should buy for himself. Generally this doesn't happen. Women buy more clothing than men. وَلَا تَضْرِبِ الْوَجْهِ, and do not strike her on face. Do not strike her on the face. It doesn't mean that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is encouraging, do not strike on face, but strike her. No, because next hadith denies this. وَلَا تَضْرِبِ الْوَجْهِ. Why wajh? Face is the place of respect, self-respect. And hitting a person upon the face is adding insult to injury. It is not just hurting the face and the body, it is hurting the heart. So hitting a person upon the face is not just hurting but insulting also. So he said you should not hit the face, hit the person on the face. وَلَا تَضْرِبِ الْوَجْهِ وَلَا تُقَبِّهِ, and do not curse her or do not call her ugly, and do not make dua for Allah to Allah for making her ugly on the day of judgment. وَلَا تُقَبِّحْ وَلَا تَهْجُرْ إِلَّا فِي الْبَيْتِ وَهَجُرُهُنَّ فِي الْمَضَاجِ. In the Quran, Allah says that if you see any indecency in your wife, so you should stop talking to her and you should separate yourself from her. But this should be at home, not in public. Like cutting off relation with the woman temporarily for her correction, because the husband is responsible. He should take care of that the wife is not indecent. To correct her, he should cut off relation temporarily with her. But he should not send her out of the home, like some people do. When they are angry with the woman, with the wife, they first beat her and they throw her out of the house and close the door. This is not the way. This is not the decent way of correcting the wife. وَلَا تَهْجُرْ إِلَّا فِي الْبَيْتِ. If you have any anger and if you have any disconnection between you and the wife, that should not go public. You are telling other people, you are talking to other people and showing the people that I am not talking to my wife, because that is her respect among other women. If they know this, they will make a joke, they will make fun of it, and she will feel bad. So it is told that the husband should not cut off relation with the woman, wife, at only outside the house, but only at home, if it is necessary. وَلَا تَهْجُرْ إِلَّا فِي الْبَيْتِ. If you want to show anger, show it at home, not outside the house. And Abu Dawud says, وَلَا تُقَبِّحْ أَن تَقُولْ قَبَّحَكِ اللَّهِ. وَلَا تُقَبِّحْ means that you curse the wife, that may Allah do taqbih of you. May Allah darken your face. May Allah make your face ugly on the day of judgment. So this dua against the woman is taqbih. And in another narration, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, La tadribu ima Allah. Do not strike or beat the bond women or slave women of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In a very short hadith and small hadith, he says, do not beat, do not strike, la tadribu. So he has totally denied and rejected and prohibited that the husband should not beat his wife. Not just striking on the face, that is an additional thing. But la tadribu, do not beat, do not strike. La tadribu ima Allah. And saying ima Allah, he's signifying, he's directing attention to the fact that she is not your slave. She is the slave of Allah. She is subordinate to you, no doubt. الرِّجَالُ قَوَّامُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ. Women are subordinate. So, but one should not become the owner of women or hurt them, becoming the owner and doing whatever he wants with them and beating them and insulting them and throwing them out of the homes and sending them to their parents and doing all sorts of evil things. No. La tadribu ima Allah. Do not beat or do not strike the bond women or slave women of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he's saying that they are your subordinate, no doubt. But they are the slaves of Allah, they are not your slave. So ima Allah, they are the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, that is in extreme cases, like when even cutting off relation with her, not talking to her and not sharing the bed with her, even after that, if she does not gets corrected and she does not leave the indecency, then he can strike her, but not beat her badly, taking her to the hospital like. So he can use some meeting her with siwak or something, that is allowed. But that is in extreme cases. So it is not like every time the husband is angry, he can beat her out and throw her out of home. No, it is not correct. It is not halal. She will come on the day of judgment and take his hasanat, because he has done injustice to her. Doing justice to the wives. A difficult hadith for women. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا كان عند الرجل امرأتان فلم يعدل بينهما جاء يوم القيامة وشقه ساقط. Imam al-Tirmidhi and Hakim has narrated this hadith, and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, when a man has two wives and he is not just between them, he does not do justice between them, he will come on the day of judgment, جَاءَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَشِقُّهُ سَاقِطٌ, and one of his sides will be drooping. He will not be a balanced person. Why? Because he was not balanced in dunya. الْجَزَاءُ مِنْ جِنْسِ الْعَمَلِ. Ulama say that whatever jaza is there in the akhirah, it is similar to the wrongdoings a person has done in this life. So since he did not do justice and there was no balance, Allah has created man in balance, but on the day of judgment, because he did not do justice between the two wives, what will happen? One of his sides will be drooping. So he will not be able to walk properly on the day of judgment. And that will be the sign, and people will know that this person was, he had two wives and he did not do justice between the two wives. So this will be the punishment. This hadith shows and signifies and teaches us that if a person has two wives, he should do justice between the two wives in providing. Maybe he loves one wife more than the other, but that is feeling, and you cannot weigh the feelings. You cannot divide and make equal feelings for even for your children, your friends, your brothers, and your relatives. No one can do this, to love in equal measure all the people you are related to. You cannot do this. That is from inside. So that person may love one wife more than the other, but in providing and dealing and behavior, he should be just. He should not show love to one and hatred and anger to the other. No, he should deal both kindly and provide whatever they need, food and clothing and home and everything that they need, and the education of the children, everything what a normal person requires in this life. So if he does not do this, جَاءَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَشِقُّهُ سَاقِتْ, he will come on the day of judgment and his side will be drooping. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught that husbands should not hate their wives. If women were ugly and evil and devilish and source of all wrong, he would have told men to hate them as much as possible. But he did not do this. On the contrary, he taught them, even if they have some shortcomings, he should not hate them. He should not dislike them. And Abi Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يفرق مؤمن مؤمنة إن كره منها خلقا رضي منها آخر أو قال غيره. Imam Muslim narrates this hadith. Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم says, a believing man, a Muslim person, man should not hate a believing woman, that is his wife. If he dislikes one of her characteristics, one of the things in her nature, in her behavior, in her dealings, in her living, if he dislikes something in her, he will be pleased with another quality. If she has some shortcomings, she will have some good things in her, and you will like her because of these good things. So, sometimes people get married, and both of them, after some months, they realize, the husband and the wife both, they realize that the husband has some shortcomings, the wife has some shortcomings. Sometimes the people who join the marriage and they are part of this relationship, they convey messages with exaggeration. Maybe she has memorized some surah, 5 or 10, they make 10, 20, 100. Sometimes they say she has memorized the whole Quran, and at night she gets up in the night and you tell her to read anything, she can read it with tilawa and tajweed and qira, everything, like Qari Abdul Basit or someone. So sometimes when they talk about men and women, even about men, he earns so much that he does not have place to keep. So they convey messages wrongly and with exaggeration in praise. But when they marry and when they meet each other, when they learn about each other, they find that there are good things in them and there are shortcomings. There are weaknesses, and maybe sometimes the husband is short-tempered, the wife does not know how to cook. She goes in the kitchen and stares at the vessels all the time. She doesn't know how to cook. and the mother-in-law is shouting, what did you see in her and you married her? And all this happens and, you know, the family gets destroyed. So, yeah. So, there are such things. Maybe sometimes she cannot talk properly to relatives. She talks sometimes silly things. Maybe the husband, he has some more bigger weaknesses. He smokes. Sometimes some things come into life. And sometimes they find about them each other after the marriage. Now, the talaq is in the hands of the husband. And often he unjustly, because of some weaknesses and some shortcomings in the woman, he says, I don't want this woman and I want to marry someone else. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited this. He taught the man to look at the brighter side. He taught the man to see goodness in her. Because no matter who, every person has some goodness, no matter how many weaknesses are there in him or her. So he said, La yafraq mu'minun mu'mina. A mu'min should not hate a mu'mina. A believing man should not hate a believing woman, that is his wife. In kariha minha khuluqan, if he does not like one thing in her, radiya minha akhar, he will be content with another quality she possesses, with maybe other women do not. Faithfulness, doing the work at home, standing by his side, waiting for him after cooking the meal he likes, and tending and taking care of the children, and helping in washing his clothes, and doing all the household work, and many other things. So there are many goodnesses and good things in women. And the husband should not see some little things which are there in women, and because of that he should not hate her. So Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the point is that he taught and told and commanded men not to hate wives. They are not to be hated. And he said that they have some goodness. You keep your eyes on that goodness. No matter, there will be shortcomings. Don't stare at these things, you will lose her. You will lose her. If you pay attention to all these weaknesses, these are small things, but because of that, your relationship will be severed and it may be spoiled. So you look at the good things in her. And this is not just for the wife, this is for all the relationships. Brothers, sisters, parents, children, friends. If we look at the weaknesses, shortcomings, the defects in her and them, we will lose them and we will hate them. But if we look at the good things which every heart possesses, every person has some good qualities. If we look at these qualities, the relationship and the bonding strengthens. So this is the basic principles, the very, very, very important principle of good relationship, the husband and the wife. This is for the husband, the hadith is for the husband, but this can also be for the wife. So she has to look at the good qualities that the husband has and ignore the weaknesses. If these weaknesses are not sins, if they are sins, she should try to correct him. Who is the better man? And Abi Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi sallam, akmalul mu'minina imanan ahsanuhum khuluqa wa khayrukum linisa'ihim. Rasul sallallahu alayhi sallam said, the most complete and the most perfect of the believers in faith are those, is the one with the best character. أحسنهم خلقا, the best of the believers in Iman, the most perfect Iman is the Iman of a person. He is the person with best Iman, perfect Iman, who أحسنهم خلقا, who is with the best of the character, best of character among other believers. وَخَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِنِسَائِهِمْ And the best of you are those who are best to your wives. وَخَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِنِسَائِهِمْ And the best among you are those who are good to their wives. So in this hadith, we learn that akhlaq, khuluqun hasan, akhlaq is directly related to iman. And iman can be judged, the power of iman, the perfection of iman depends upon a person's akhlaq, his character. His dealing with people, his character and his nature. وَخَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِنِسَائِهِمْ And the test of a man being good, whether he is good or not, how can he be judged? It depends upon how he treats his wife, how he behaves with his wife at home or outside home. وَخَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِنِسَائِهِمْ If he is unjust to his wife, if he talks to her in a wrong way, if he hurts her feelings, insults her, if he does not provide her, if he does not behave properly, decently with her, then he is not a good person and his iman is low. His iman is weak. So a powerful iman will make a person good to others, especially those who are near to him, like wife and children. So this is a very important hadith, and this shows that akhlaq is directly related to iman. Bad akhlaq will result in weak iman. It is the result of weak iman. And if we do not live a good life with others, then our iman goes down. So we should take care of iman, and a good iman will make a person behave properly in the society, especially at home. And a good person is a good person who is good at home. A good person is not a person who is a saint outside and Firaun at home. A good person is a person who is good at home. So why? Because people meet us once in a while. So it's so easy to be good to them. But repeatedly, we have to deal with our family members, and then it is known that whether really we follow a principle or we are trying to please people.
Familiarity breeds contempt.
Pardon?
Familiarity breeds contempt.
Yes. Familiarity breeds contempt. If we meet people most often, so often, slowly, there are things which we do not like about each other. The more we know each other, the more we start hating each other. So we do bad things to our family members and we are good to others. The husband hates the wife and he is good to his people, colleagues at the company and working place. Wife is good to her relatives, the neighbors, the women, and she is not good to the husband. So this is not good. So a good person, a believer, is a person who is good to his family members, especially the wife. So I think this is enough for today, and we will be trying to finish the rest of the material tomorrow, inshallah. I think we should start. What time should we start? 3 o'clock. Waqi. 3 means 3. Yes, definitely. So I will be starting the class at 3, no matter how many students are there. So we will start at 3 sharp, mostly at 3:05, inshallah. Any questions? Yeah, we can go in a short time before Adhan. Any questions are there? Yes. Yeah.
How?
Yes. In the times of the Prophet ﷺ, women were deemed as weak creatures. And because of them, in wars, people had to suffer because they were made captives. And because of them, they had to bow down to other tribes. And that's why they used to bury their daughters. So this is a test that when they are in his care, he provides them with what they need and they are going to some other house. So he is not going to get anything in return. But as far as the sons are considered, they will earn money and come to the family back. And they will add to the power of the family. They will save the family. They will stay with the father. So he will in return he will get something from the sons, but not from the daughters. So they are the test whether he really fears Allah or not. He behaves and he treats them well or not. So that's a test. That's a test. That he is not going to receive anything from the daughters. Rather, he will have to send them. And in the society, having sons is power and having daughters is weakness, especially in those times. So he said that this is a test. Whether you bury them or you carry them, it's a test. So I think this is enough for today, inshallah. Barakallahu feekum. We will continue and start the rest of it tomorrow, inshallah.